My name is Tyler David, and you're watching Field of Dreams on ACTN.
Okay, I just saw you playing all day, and you look real good. Who are you?
Well, you know, I'm Ilunga Kiza. I'm the best footballer pointer of the season.
Oh, really? You know any of the older players who play here?
Well, I know Warren Archibald, Leroy Dillion.
Stop. You know me? Boy, I was the best striker, the best forward that this country ever seen.
Oh, Wilfred K.
Boy, I'm Steve David, boy.
Hey everybody, welcome to another edition of Field of Dreams. This is ACTN. My name is Steve David. I'm your host. Today we talk formation in football because, as you know, there is so many different formations in the, you know, the game is 11 against 11, but coaches form so many different formations. Let's discuss some of the formations. To help me do that, I've got two coaches. Dick Verlong, you the coach of Point Forward and Civic, right, Dick?
Welcome. Presently.
And you help me along with some of the formations?
Well, yes and no. Yes and no, in the sense that I personally believe that we try to keep the players to a fix. To a one, given a system, a formation, a play, and I think that we have to move away from that, and move into to more elaborate formation of coaching.
Okay, I'll give you time. Yeah. It's time so we can discuss that.
Yeah.
All right?
Right.
And let me introduce also Dexter Cyrus, and Dexter, you coach of the Palaseco team, and you also coach St. Benedict's College.
Well, ex-coach at St. Benedict's.
You're not the coach. What happened to you and St. Benedict's College, by the way? St. Benedict's College went from number one, or almost winning, to almost getting knocked out of the college's football league. What is the story? You must be a great coach, bud. So tell me, what's your secret?
Steve, you know, we had all the bases covered when I was there, and I came in with a very comprehensive program,
mm-hmm.
That was taken away from the players, from the school, and the justification is what I think the footballing fraternity has a problem with. You know, what did you use to justify moving Dexter Cyrus, who was so successful for 5 years, and the management team came up with all sorts of stuff, all sorts of things, like they didn't think I was being hands-on enough with the players and all sorts of stuff.
Nothing to do with formation?
Nothing to do with formation, nothing to do with your results, nothing to do with anything like that.
Results, right.
You know,
right.
They had a problem with the fact that sometimes I would come and they want to know why I still have on my jersey, but you all never gave me a jersey.
Right.
So, you know, all sorts of nonsense.
Okay.
But it's just the fact that they wanted somebody else. They wanted somebody
else. They got somebody else
who they could control.
Turn out very good.
Nah, it didn't turn out
very good. And all kudos to you for that.
Yeah.
But you find another job somewhere with some other college to,
most definitely.
To do the best.
Most definitely.
Can. Okay, guys, we want to talk formation in football. Dick and Dexter. And I know the oldest formation that I know is the one we call the WM formation. You remember that, Dick?
Yes, but as I was telling you before, I knew of our system before.
Before. What was that one before that?
That was called the Catanacio.
Okay.
That is when they played with five forwards, five offensive players,
mm-hmm.
two midfielders, and just three defenders. So in other words, they were playing with a right wing, a left wing, an inside right, an inside left, and what they called at that time a backward center forward. This is this actually similar formation that they call the WM formation. It's only the difference in that is that now the striker play more up front, not as a backward striker. So you get the formation of with letters W and M forming.
Let me let the viewers understand what that is. So the WM is the right wing, the left wing, and the center forward is up front.
Front, yeah.
And then the two inside forwards, the inside right and the inside left, come back
at
a little
time. That's right. That's right.
And then the M is the two midfielders
mm-hmm.
with the right back, the left back,
and the central. That's right.
That makes that peak, that mm-hmm. WM. You know anything about that, Dexter? You ever heard of that one?
Yeah, it's more like a 3-5-2, but with two withdrawn guys. The 3-5-2, the WM, really, 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 really successful in that era when everybody was playing 3-5-2. And then, you know, coaches started transitioning formations based on where the ball was. And based on where the ball is, we change our shape. We tuck in, we push up, and then you find certain formations, they couldn't counteract the fact that coaches were actually coaching transition formation. They are still doing that now. Transition formation has taken over the world. And based on where the ball is and based on if the ball is in our half or in the next team half, the players and they would change their shape and their movement and be in certain places. It takes a lot of work in structuring in preseason to make sure that players get that right. But now, that is what has taken over the world. I was pretty sure that Chelsea was not going to beat Tottenham just because of the fact that three back cannot win the English league. There are too many good wing backs on the other teams. Tottenham has the best two wing backs in England in the form of Walker and Rose. Pushing them high up the field, which Pochettino did, forced the two wide men from Chelsea to play from so deep that they couldn't offer any width coming forward. And Tottenham got the result.
Okay, so let's talk about... I want the viewers to understand. Viewers, I want you to understand what the WM formation is, what they played in the back in the day when they had five forwards, two midfielders, and three guys in the back. And football was played in front of both teams' goal and very little in the middle of the park, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because that
mm-hmm.
five forwards against three defenders, and on the other side, the same thing. Was that exciting football back in the day? And what do you think?
Well, it was exciting. It was exciting, Steve, in the sense that you were to be looking and seeing more attacking more than just the defending side of the game, because people love to see goals.
Right.
I could remember Brazil. In the latter 60s, they were using it very effectively because they had people like Gadi Garincha, they had the people like the Pele, the Vava, and these fellas, and them playing. So that you were getting the opportunity to see football in a more artistic way rather than football played in a more choreographed way. Players were more free in that sense to show the level of intelligence and creativity. Today, football is a more kind of choreographed business. I want you to move here, I want you to come here, if they go here, this, no. But having said that, being the one that's coaching Civic Center at this present time, I am looking at our formation, I'm looking at our talent that we have at our exposure. And I believe now that we can play what I would call free flow football, but understanding the systematic and movements that is going to be required.
Where to be, and
yes, rather than have to tell you, like, when the ball is here, I want you to run here, and I want you.
So
I'm talking formation, right?
Mm-hmm.
But formation, I'm going to put formation into a systematic. Let me break it down like this. I just say like a Trinidadian. I could play the pan, but I want to be able to play the pan from the wrong side too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
You look at it.
Yeah.
So, Dexter, you think of WM formation will work now in this time?
Yeah, any formation could work based on the players you have. Any formation could work based on the players you have. It's just a situation where sometimes you might feel you need to choose a formation, but the formation end up choosing you.
Right.
So if I have three top quality stoppers, am I going to say turn a stopper into a wing back or leave him on the bench and he's a stopper? I try him in different positions and it doesn't work out. Am I going to say leave him on the bench? Am I going to do that or am I going to play a system where I can play the best players
right.
on any given match day? If you are faced with the fact that you have a Dexter Cyrus, a Peter Prosper, and a Philbert Jones, which Edgar Vidal was faced with that fact coaching United Petrotrin, what do you do?
Play them all.
You have to find a way to play them all.
Mm-hmm.
And he found a way. Myself and Peter Prosper, I was the leading striker, the pointer, and Peter Prosper was withdrawn. And Philbert Jones was an inside right.
Right.
And our right wing back was the guy who did all the overlapping. So that right side was so strong, we could afford to leave a defensive wing back on the opposite side
right.
and not do anything on that side because now you had to concentrate on dealing with these three boys, these three strong attackers, a midfield with that Anthony Sherwood in it and Larry Joseph and I think that would be a Hayden Ryan, the coach at Chiva Boys, right? And then you had Felix Seals coming up the right there with an engine like Aubrey David. So problems for other teams, just based on the fact that Edgar Vidal found a way
to use the players
what he had in a system that worked at the time.
So a system shouldn't be planned; it should be. Based on the players, you pick your system.
Well, mm-hmm. you see, it's not so much a system. What about your plan B? Mm-hmm. You see, because now, what if the coach of the next team does something? What if he does something after 62 minutes, 65
minutes? You have
to adjust
as well.
And you have to adjust. What are you going to do? What if you're 2 goals down and you have to win this game? What are you going to do? You need to take out a player from the... You're playing fullback. You need to sacrifice a defender, put in an extra striker because you have to win this game.
Right.
So based on the dynamics of the game and what the next coach does and all these things, you have to be able to change and play more than one system.
Okay, and then they went to 4-2-4. Explain what a 4-2-4 is for me.
It's more or less...
For the viewers.
A 4-2-4, more or less, you're talking about 4 people to the back. 2 people in the midfield and 4 people up front. That is just formation lineup. That is not the actual playing system. The playing system would now more or less entail that you're getting the 2 wide men who are forwards at that time to be able to revert to defensive things whenever the team happened to be on the defense of the ball. I mean, as Cyrus rightfully said, formations
is
only lineup. It's a lineup. I could line up in 5-5 and make you feel, if you're less educated in the game, make you feel that I played with 5 people in front and 5 people in the back. But that is not real. That is only my lineup. I would have people rotating and permutating within the movements that I decide. How I decide, and if I decide, if I know of the opponent before, I will know exactly how to approach their weak areas
using
the same lineup formation, but moving in a more systematic
way. Easy to say, though.
But you have to train it as
those players, they're confused with a 4-4-2, which is like the simplest for me.
Let me answer
and,
that.
And players get confused. Yeah, so you have to stick to systems.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, let me explain that. The today players, because of the mere fact that the majority of them start to play football from a more advanced age, meaning like 17, 18, 19, they did not go through proper programs in common. So therefore, their thinking happened to be limited. We as coaches in the present day, we have to understand how to now place the necessary knowledge together with practice. In our day, we didn't used to have to go through that because we had a form of creativity within ourselves, that things that we would love to do, but within the understanding of what the coaches needed. Today, the present player feel that because of what the public say, the accolades that the public give to them, they feel that they're good. So Dexter said it early on that they become uncoachable, not coachable. So therefore, to get through the information that you given towards the formation and the systematic movements that you need, these players are not educated to that level. So what we have to do as the present day coaches, we have to go back to classroom sessions.
Well, hence is what I say. We had to put them in a formation and kind of walk them through these drills.
No, well,
because before we throw 11 players in the field.
And they could do it.
It's standard work where you do 10 sessions of defensive structuring, 10 sessions of attacking structuring, and then you have to do 10 sessions of attacking and defensive combined. That's 30 sessions. You know how long that takes you just to do structuring? That's a month.
Right.
In the preseason, that's a month. Yeah. During which time you would have done your physical work before, and you know, you do all your nice fitness work, you do your drills and all that kind of thing. And when you're doing structuring, you do structuring leading up into playing practice games.
Right.
And then you play practice games to make sure that the players have it clear. Yeah. And then you adjust and you twinkle with your structure based on what you see in the games. And you move on game after game until you get it right. Right? The whole thing with players being confused and that kind of stuff, coaching young boys at St. Benedict's, a lot of boys are telling you, Coachman, you know, this is the first time I know this. Coachman, you know, this is the first time somebody showed me this.
Right.
Because they're not clear of their positional play based on where the ball is. They're thinking, I'm playing right back. The ball is on the opposite side, tuck in. Right. The ball comes middle, open. The ball is in front of you, go and give backward support and then look to go around. A lot of them, they don't understand that smooth
transition
for it to work like clockwork. And a lot of them don't even know it at all. They know, I defend, I give the midfield the ball, and I'm here.
Wait, what I do next? No.
And that's it.
Okay, let's take a break. When we come back, we will get into it went from WM to 424, and then it went to 433. I want you guys to explain that to the viewers. Viewers, we'll be right back after the show.
Is that the present day player must understand the functions or the principles that is required based on the position that he plays.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. worldwidesafety@yahoo.com.
Welcome back, viewers. Before the break, we were talking about the 4-2-4 formation. And now we're going to switch gear and guys, explain to the viewers what the 4-3-3 was, because that went from the WM to the 4-2-4, then to the 4-3-3. So, explain that.
It was more or less, the 4-2-4 was more or less... 4-3-3. I want to take it first from the WM 4-2-4 and then into the 4-3-3.
Right.
So what I'm saying is that what actually happened within this formation to come about with the 4-3-3, because many coaches thought at one time it was insufficient in the forward thrust, right? So they decided to remove one striker, one forward, and placed him into the midfield area. So that we now as Dexter was even saying, now with this 4-3-3, at times the overlapping. As we see
wing back or whatever.
As we see Marcelo has been doing a lot, but he's becoming more or less from like if he's playing outside the link, but really and truly he's just playing a more high up defender than how most. That's how the way that Real Madrid do it. But what I'm saying is that the 4-3-3 for me, because the system that I love it because of the mere fact I could get the first line of defense from the offensive line players, which meaning the players more up front. So that even though that I'm playing with three midfielders, I could play now the sliding door kind of midfield. So that I could get the three strikers could come here base if the attack is on the left side. They come across like truck and trailer, and I could get the other three midfielders now to take it here, to carry it this way and get the back four to form that kind of umbrella when I'm on the defense. If I'm going forward with the 4-3-3, now I could actually get five players into it because of how I'm going to play the three that come in from behind. The three up front going to be giving me 1-2-3, and then these two come in so that, as I started by saying, I'm moving back. They could take this 4-3-3 and actually move it into the five. Or 5-3-2 or 5, I could play it like that if I want.
Mm-hmm.
I could play it dropping with 5 people in the back, 2 people in the midfield, and 3 of people up front. I could convert many different forms. But all these things have to start on the practice pitch.
We know that.
It have to start there.
Dexter, how you visualize the 4-3-3 operation.
Coach Dick hit the nail on the head.
Yeah.
Because the 4-3-3 is by far one of the most difficult the systems to coach, but it is also one of the most difficult systems to play against.
Mm-hmm.
So based on the fact of its ever-evolving and changing face, the 4-3-3 has many faces. So
that's right.
Let's start from the back. In possession, you find that the two stoppers take depth and the two wing backs push into midfield and create a 5-man midfield. When whichever side the ball is on, that wing back pushes straight up the field and becomes the wide midfielder on the line of the offside as though he's a wide striker. That's on the side that the ball is on. On the opposite side, some coaches play with a L. They leave home the next wing back. And some coaches push the two wing backs at the same time, still leaving the front three across the middle, and a withdrawn attacking center midfielder that goes to join to create 6 across your front. Yeah. But that can only happen with teams who are very good in possession. You take that chance because of the fact that you can be assured that they're not going to lose the ball. Good on the ball players who could handle the ball well, so you find that Barcelona could just commit players forward because the players are able to keep possession of the ball. You don't want to commit 5 and 6 and 7 players forward and the ball is breaking down. You're going to get good. Right? The ever-changing face of this 4-3-3 based on sometimes you invert your triangle in midfield where you play 2 at the bottom, 1 at the top. Then you could play 1 at the bottom and 2 at the top. And the center forward now has 2 withdrawn attacking midfielders to join and get past him at any point in time, especially if a coach realizes that the next team stoppers are weak. You know? The whole aspect of wing backs, what we call overlapping wing backs, coming into football, is one of the most key factors and components in the 4-3-3. Because there's no point in you asking a wide forward to do all that work for 90 minutes and then the next game, and then, no, he shouldn't have to come so far back. And also, the wing back must always be backward of him so that he could have that backward support at all times. A midfielder shouldn't have to come out. You understand?
You guys have the modern-day 4-3-3 because the 4-3-3 that I remember and I played in that I like, the best formation that I like, we had 2 strikers, and the third man, the third forward was either a right wing or a left wing. Or he could go either side he wants.
Mm-hmm. That's right, yeah.
Or sometimes, if one of the strikers open up as a wing, he joins as another striker. Yeah. So we have always with 2 strikers when the ball is going down, either line. Right. You know, one open out. And so we always with 2 guys in the middle, which I love. And then the midfield, just push and hold and support.
But there are some teams that do that because the attacking midfielder is / withdrawn striker.
Right.
And when the ball is in the opposing team half, he pushes right up the field and commits the other stopper. So you find you get 4 across the front with the both wide forwards holding full width.
Mm-hmm.
And these 2 men now come in and committing the two stoppers with the backward support from the 2 defensive midfielders.
Mm-hmm.
To unlock a good team defense with that now is with the overlapping wing back. The wing back must be coming from deep.
Right. Okay, so they went from that 4-3-3 to a 4-4-2 to take out another forward and drop him in the midfield. And now that was supposed to be well structured, well, a lot of balance, have the width, the shape, and everything, right? The 4-4-2.
Yeah, yes, but there is balance in respect to feel dimensions. I say that to say simply say, all right, the field is 80 yards wide. We have 4 people playing across. Each player know that his average space for coverage on the defense of the ball is probably just about 20 yards wide. But that is 20 yards in dimension. That is not 20 yards in reality. Why I say it like this? Because let me say that 3 of us playing. It's 4 of us to play the midfield. But 3 of us, the ball is on the right side. You go across to challenge, right? I am coming to give cover. Dexter is giving me counter cover. In reality, none of us is really covering 20 yards because we are supportive to each other. Now, the 4-4-2, for me, you have to have intelligent players. Because 2 up front, if you go to say just you're playing 2 people up front, let me say it this way too. Have you ever seen a bird flying without wing? It can happen.
A plane of wings. Okay.
Yeah, correct. So, therefore, in systems, especially like 4-4-2, you have to have players who have that level of intelligence to know how and when to create this wing. So that these two players on the inside here could keep the people, two central defenders, or if they have three central defenders, always occupy, which would now give added thing for these men that have to that come in, these four men, to start, these two men here now to start falling into striking positions. No, you have to be able to understand it.
And Dexter, jump in here.
Yeah.
The 4-4-2.
Yes,
is
correct.
If I'm on the attack, my two midfielders push in. Now I have four men up front, so I still have my 4-4-2
right.
with two men in the back, because my two wing backs, where my two midfielders go,
yes, the
my
two wing backs
go.
So you end up with a 2-4-4.
Well, two behind,
right?
Two behind, but on the reverse. Right. That is the reverse.
But it's in the reverse.
Call it 4-4-2
in reverse.
Yeah, that is reverse.
And then so it's like they tied on to each other.
Right.
Yes.
So when you go, you
must be able.
That's right. What I thought. It's structured like that.
But it is structured like that. You go again.
Dexter,
you know what? The 4-4-2. There are two very important components that you must have in order for that system to be successful. One, you have 8 players playing from behind the ball when you win it. So let's say you keep 2 strikers up front at all times. You ask the 4 across the middle to tuck off to give coverage to the 4 in the back. That's 8 players behind the ball from the time you play an outlet pass. Outlet pass into the striker. The most important thing at that time is the ability for the striker to hold up the ball so that we can get out and get
support.
Past the ball in order to get overlap plays to score. The next thing with that is you have to have excellent wing play.
Let's talk about wing.
Wing play must be excellent in 4-4-2 because now the wide midfielder is playing 15 yards forward of the wing back. The right midfielder and the right back must play in tandem.
That's why I say they're supposed to be like they're on the stick.
Because
they're working together.
They must play in tandem. We must have these two things. Now, with your two-man midfield in the middle, you find that a team that is playing 4-3-3 would have 3 men in the middle.
You would never have 2 in the middle, though, on a 4-4-2.
No. 4-4-2, we're talking about down the spinal column. So now we have 2 here, 1 here, 1 here. Right? You have 2 here and 2 here. These two men in that coverage area playing against 4-3-3, a triangle in the middle against 2 in the middle. Okay. Right? That now says that I'm outnumbered in that area. How do I counteract that?
How you outnumbered? If we're on defense, if they're on defense, you got 4 in the midfield.
You got 4 in the midfield, but
only
two
when we attack, we go with the 2.
Right, but you got 2 wide.
Okay, but
are you asking a wide man to
come
in? If I
go attack right side, my left back don't have to go.
Right.
He don't have to go. He can wait.
Right.
So he can support.
Right.
Like you said, against 3 other people in the midfield.
Right, but now you have to make it clear to the player where is his start position. Because start position is only clear to players when you put a structure on nice on the blackboard and you go on the field and you practice and you build it out of the back and they understand the start position. From the time the opponent starts to overload one side and starts to bring you inside and bring a next man around, they're confused. Why are they confused? Because we didn't make it clear for them where is their start position. The start position at all times remains the start position. At no time you should get sucked in to start in front of the stopper. That is a man pulling you out of position. Learn to understand these things.
Let me just kind of interject here for a second. I think the majority of our problem lie, if you ask one at the present day player, I am speaking at even at the national level, regardless of the position that they play. If you ask any one of them, let me say for instance, who play on the defense, ask a defender, tell me the principles of defense. He cannot start to answer. So therefore, you know already he's playing this game more or less of how he
instinctively.
That's right, correct. Yeah. Rather than if you
with the clear
present,
knowledge.
Yeah, with the present day player, with the how coaches deal with it now, presently, is that the present day player must understand the functions or the principles that is required based on the position that he play. So therefore, each player is just like in a film, an actor, each actor is given a special script. So you, that player must be given a role. But you see, because of the lack of education in the game of football, when you give that player a role, he doesn't know how to really carry it out. Because this is something that I'm seeing time and time again. You're giving them role, you're making them understand what your role is, and you're making them understand what the functional outside is. They say to you, yes, yes, we understand. But when you put them on the field of play, it's not happening. When you do it in practice, when it is calm and comfortable, you're seen like it's happening.
Yeah.
But when they get into actual competition...
Yeah. When you can't control the opponent.
But
these things is formation.
Tell me if I'm wrong. The most systematic formation that everybody could stay in the spot and play the entire game...
It's 4-4-2.
It's 4-4-2.
Yeah, because it uses that...
You don't have to move.
All right. This has come just like how we know Carnival come in so and so time. So we know about that. But if we have to move on to the other levels, the higher level, we must know about...
I
cannot be a mathematician.
Right.
And I don't know formulas. I only know 1 and 1 is 2. 12 and 12 multiplied by 2 is 24. I'm saying that in this sense, if we bring about players just knowing about one particular formation or system of play, we would have problem to beat. And we've seen it with Trinidad football. Anytime we step out of the Caribbean, we are beaten. Anytime.
All right, viewers, let's take a break. And when we come back, I want you guys to tell me what you think is your best formation and why. Viewers, we'll be right back after the short break.
That's my favorite.
Okay.
But my 4-3-3 is always played with the slash attacking midfielder with drawn striker who goes to join the center forward.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. worldwidesafety@yahoo.com.
Okay, welcome back, viewers. Before the break, we were talking about the 4-4-2, which I thought was the simplest and easiest formation to put down and have people follow. My two coaches here, I know they have other opinions about that. So I would ask you guys to tell me individually, what is your best formation and why?
All right. For me, to start with, the formation that I love the best, it is the 3-5-2. Reason
three,
for that.
Three up front or three in the back?
Three to the
starting
back.
Starting from the back.
three from the back.
So 3-5-2.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. But we not one in the cut here.
Yeah, go on.
We need to make mention of the goalkeeper when we talk
goalkeeper, right? Correct. We have to vary.
It's 1-3-5-2.
It's 1-3-5-2.
5-2, okay. Correct. All right, then. Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. It's 1-3-5-2.
That's
five,
your best. And explain why.
Yeah, yeah, good. Now, what I love about the 3-5-2, starting from the formation lineup, it makes you see clearly I cover the entire width of the field.
How?
Correct. Because I have a man on each side.
Two wing backs?
No. I have the five across.
Oh, is that in the middle?
Correct.
Okay.
Because this is where I want to control the game. Because the game of itself starts from there.
Okay.
The touch off, everything is from there. So if I could capitalize on the midfield play, 90% of the game is mine already, if I can capitalize. So I love to be able to shut down from the outside. Put traffic on the inside. Plug it up hard here. And play the triangular formation which each wing back or central defenders giving me the triangular formation that I need, because if I have five men here, we'll have two men here, and a man in the middle. So this man would give me this to the center, he would get, I'd still get that triangular formation, and if I move to the other side, I will get at that triangular formation. But as I go higher up the pitch, now, my system now start to move from the three to the, from the five to the midfield, let me start there first, because these two men,
the two white guys,
correct, starting to go.
They're
joining the front. These two from white. from the tree in the back come up, and this man appear, the back one, appear as me, libero.
So you have a 1-1-5.
You have this here going
there. Yeah, the goalkeeper, then one guy, then five across the middle, and four
correct,
on the
correct, because
top.
My mm-hmm. goalkeeper is also right. a defender. When we have the ball,
right.
or when the ball is lost, based on where it is lost, how high up the pitch, it will now say clearly what position he would hold in case for this overhead ball, if the team win the ball it, and it beat my backman, he would be able to win it quite easily. But I'm not really so concerned on the defense of it yet. I am thinking about, it's like boxing, that's how I just think about it. If two fellas boxing, or people boxing, and a man jabbing, what you have to do to defend? If I have a great number coming at you, and more so the number is concentrated on the inside, you have plenty problems to deal with. Even if it is, if the attack break, because of the number that I have in that forward thrust, I could start to work to win the ball immediately. I don't have to wait.
Let me give you a chance to breathe and think. I'll come back to you. Let me get yours, Cyrus, on your formation and what you think is best and why.
For me, because of, well, my formation would be indicative of the player that I was.
Okay.
A striker.
Okay.
And I like to see the attack with numbers. That being said, 4-3-3 is my
that's my
favorite.
Okay.
But my 4-3-3 is always played with the slash attacking midfielder with drawn striker who goes to join the center forward late and fast at all times. And the wide forward on the opposite side of the ball that comes in and also joins the center forward in the box. So we always have three in there. The teams that I coach always score a lot of goals. But that system also gives me the opportunity to play how I like to play in defense. And I like to play press.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like to play drop off. Mm-hmm. I like to play press all the time. Force you to play in tight areas and force you to play in a box, a crowded box all the time. So it makes me play the way I want to play in attack, and it makes me play the way I want to play in defense, you know? And that 4-3-3, you could change it up so much, sometimes so much. You know, you can make your strikers and then play the width of the box. Sometimes you can make them play full drawn out to the full width of the field. You can make the two strikers stay in on the peak of the box and play a lot of book crosses into the box so that they're always in position close to the goal to get to score. You can make your wing backs and they one play high and one play low. You can play with an attacking wing back one day and a defensive wing back the next day and force that one wing back to play and go and join and overload on that side. So the 4-3-3 gives you the ability to change it up so differently in a lot of ways. Finally, in the middle of the field, you could invert your triangle all the time. When you play two at the bottom, you could switch it and play two at the top. Sometimes you could play three flat. You know, so the 4-3-3, I think, is for me is by far the best system that you could think of it.
Okay, right. Now, Dick, I want you to show Cyrus how you're gonna beat his 4-3-3, and then he gonna show you how
right.
he gonna come to you.
Correct. Good. Now he played 4-3-3, so mathematically, I don't start to understand mathematically from his offensive playing, he has 7 in numbers. You have to remember football is also about a numbers game.
You have 7 and he has 6?
No.
Offensively?
I have 7.
7 and he has 6?
Yes, correct. He
so
has
you
6.
So you outnumber him by 1?
Yes, correct. So therefore, I know football is my numbers. If I, at all times, could get more numbers around the ball, I know most of the times, I could gain that upper hand on you because I'm starting with a numerical advantage.
But he outnumbered you in defense.
But wait, no, that is going offensively. If I'm dropping on the defense now, because the game is forward and backward. So if I'm dropping now on the defense, I have 8.
You have 8.
Correct, I have 8. I have 5 midfielders.
Yes, true.
And 3 defenders.
Five. Okay,
and
I got correct. You. 8 against 7.
So, all the time.
So you all the time you have
all the time. All the time. All
I like
the
that.
Time.
I like that.
Yeah. All the time. Both forward and backward. It's just I make sure that every cube on my half of the field, because we're playing on the field of 110 yards, I know I'm making sure that every cube, based on what you're coming from, I have people in these positions.
Cyrus shaking his head like, yeah. Come on, tell him why he can't handle you, Cyrus, on that.
It's, you know, coaches try to play me with the three back already, and a three back never beat me before. So
wait. I want to correct him there one time. Not yet. I don't want him to finish because I don't want it to slip the thought.
Okay.
I could remember TN Tech training on St. Benedict's ground.
Right?
We played a practice game. The first half of the game, I watched Cyrus, how he thinking. I said, right, good. With the college boys, I said, right. I'm going to give him a little lesson in the team. And he told me that he now say that he never lose. So I want to bring back his memory. Quick.
You play 4-4-2, coach man.
No, the lineup.
Don't try that.
The lineup.
You play 4-4-2 back, coach man.
Let me get to this point. Plenty people or plenty teams are full with formation lineup.
Right.
I did it to Naparima College with St. Benedict's College and defeated Naparima College. And I said a while ago, I played with what seemed to look like 5 by 5.
But
it wasn't really 5 by 5 in formation lineup, but not 5 by 5 in systematic playing. And I could remember I was going to tell you about Cyrus. That same evening when we played, we gave Cyrus a comfortable 3 and make him comfortable with that.
Maybe he had better players.
No,
that was Benedict. That was St. Benedict.
Yeah, he was St. Benedict.
St. Benedict's
St. Benedict's,
St. Benedict's, St. Benedict's College.
Yeah, oh, playing okay. Tiantek.
I remember the game. Yeah, I remember correct. The game. Yeah.
All right, okay. So he destroyed your 4-3-3.
St. Benedict's won the game. Yeah. Albeit that, you know, the nucleus of my team, of the Tiantek team, had to stay out. I had to, you know, we played the guys who wasn't getting a run in and that kind of thing.
Well, probably that could have been.
But it was definitely a good game by Coach Mann.
Right.
Right. But
your
the three back with the five across the middle, I'm going to force those wide men to have to play from the line of the defense. I'm going to push my wide men right up the field.
Right.
Commit these two wide men across that five to go back and make five across the back and take over the middle of the field. If I can control the middle of the field all the time, then I'm going to control the pace of the game, dictate the speed of the game, dictate how much I make the opponent run, and simply play off the front in the pockets that are created. So playing against the tree is not difficult if you have good wingers.
Well, this was not going to tell you because I'm going to push.
Yeah, but even though you push two men out of your three to make it five, is that what you're saying?
What's that?
You're saying that you push in two men up to force him to have five across the middle?
Five across the back.
Five across the back?
Push my wing back.
All right, so you have so now he has three in the middle, but and you have three in the middle too.
Right.
Yeah, even.
If I take my three strikers and put them across the front and take my two wing backs and push them, that is three by two. I totally consume everybody 1v1, and how much do I have now coming from the back?
If you get Conkton now, you have one guy.
I don't have one in the back.
Huh?
I don't have one in the back.
No, yeah. If he pushed his
two men. I have two defensive midfielders.
What he's saying, if he pushed these two men up the field, right? In order to try to push the two men that I have wide back on the defense mm-hmm, of the mm-hmm, ball. Mm-hmm. Now, seeing that he pushed these men up front, I would automatically don't know, look, I have inside space here for any time that I win that ball because he have two men that he push up to make me have to go back to defend. Right to push these men back. So if he have to push these men here and here from his team have to stay open because these defenders have to cover the inside. Correct.
The only reason why I will give you win is because you come up with you tell me and you show me where you had, you always have one guy more than him
all the time.
But all
the time.
With that three back, when you push the wide men back, you have to counter from too deep.
Yeah, but from the wide men, what I'm pushing, if I have to go on the defense, automatically, I would now become stronger more in the back because I'm going to have five men, you could say, to the back now.
However you push them, he has one man more than you.
I have one man.
But you have to counter from too deep.
All the time.
You have to counter from too deep or you're scoring.
No, if I break, if one,
are you scoring goals?
When I win the ball now.
Are you winning the game?
No, listen, how are we going to do now?
Are you winning the game?
When I'm going to show how I win.
Yeah, let me see.
When I get the ball now.
So many players from deep.
Correct, yes, I'm coming from deep. But when I win the ball, I have the numbers that we could put it together and play pap, 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 pap. I'm not going to hit it out to give you the chance to think. So I'm going to play it, knock ball possession, coming out. Because I have the numbers do that.
So by which time my team is not going to get time
correct.
To come back?
No, yes, well, I'm going to say exactly that.
By which time my team is not going to get time
your team going to get... No,
to
listen.
Talk off?
Yeah, but who going to... Listen, here you're going to get strangled.
Because if you want to play all our possession come out...
I'm coming out.
By which time my team could talk off, you could play all our possession in front of me, no problem.
No. I'm coming out.
No problem.
But hear what I done certain already. In coming out, I am going to make sure that you become less in number because your strikers... going to be left out now, and I'm going to deal with now a lesser number because I'm going to make sure that your strikers get leave out with the play and I start to push it forward. That's how I just look at it. That's how I just look at my
all
games. Analyze my games.
Always outnumber you by one.
It's a nice way to look at it, but
yeah.
You have to counter from too deep. too many players coming from deep.
But you see me, you're using...
So you lose balance, you lose balance.
No, you're using wingers.
Okay.
All right, I got a few minutes left.
Just a matter of how you coach it.
Summarize formation and what you think is the best. Well, you already told me what you think is the best. And whatever you want to say about it.
What I think is the best for me.
Yes.
Coach Man will have something different.
Another coach.
Frederick will have something different. Angus will have something different. Reynold Carrington will have something different. It's what's best for me.
Right.
Jamal Shabazz will have something different.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm saying is Keith Lucloy has something. Everybody has something different, right?
Mm-hmm.
On the day when you have to look at system, you cannot be locked into a place where you don't want to change.
Right.
Correct.
If what you are accustomed doing is not working, you might have to change, not necessarily the system, you might have to tweak certain areas. So you invert your triangle, you put a more attacking player to play the attacking midfield, knowing that he would join earlier. You tweak certain things.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Sometimes our system just choose you.
Right. Ali, what do you want to, before we close?
Yeah, well, I would always say, I always believe in, especially coming up to having to play different opponents, I just love the opportunity to get a look at you. And I target your key players, your ball handlers, your playmakers, your defensive, your ball winners. And I learn to take advantage. If you have a good playmaker, I'll make sure that he hardly get anything much to really get to do.
Yeah,
you got to close.
Correct. Match the tactic. Yeah, match the tactic.
That's right. And
okay.
If you have,
we come to the end of another edition of Field of Dreams. Viewers, thank you for letting us into your homes and bringing the show to you. Thank you, Axe Television Network, for giving us the opportunity. Thank you, Cyrus, and thank you, Dick, for,
no problem.
For sharing your thoughts with us and the viewers.
No problem.
Don't forget, we have a Facebook page. Check us out, and we have an email address, fieldofdreamstt@gmail.com. Drop us a line. My name is Steve David. The show's ended. Good. Peace. I'll see you next Monday night. Good night.